I'm John Wells. I'm the president of the Dandenong Cranbourne RSL, Vietnam veteran, ex-national serviceman, ex-school teacher, ex-school principal, fruit picker, hay carter. In fact, at this age, I'm ex many, many things. I was an FO's signaller, the forward observer's signaller. We walked around with the infantry and directed artillery, had 400, left 50, all that sort of highly mathematical stuff. And it was rather funny because I became an artillery signaller on the basis that I would ride around in Land Rovers. And then they sent me to Vietnam and made me walk around with the infantry, and I felt vaguely defrauded. I had to work hard where I had planned a very easy war. But it was good. And we were good. I went to Vietnam on the 5th of July 1967. And I came home on the 21st of November that same year. 167 days, 8 hours and 20 something minutes. And I'm really annoyed that I've forgotten exactly how many minutes it was from touchdown to takeoff. I joined the Army through the National Service Scheme on the 20th of April 1966 and was discharged on the 21st of April 68. After which I went into the reserve for some years, rose to the dizzy ranks of sergeant, and had a good time doing the whole thing in a more peaceful environment. I was discharged on completion of my service, the 2 years of national service, but when I went into the Army, I was a long-haired layabout. I was out of work. I was sure that I knew more than anybody else did about nearly everything. I got into the Army and I found that there were a whole group of people who were not interested in my opinion, and I had to reevaluate a great many things. And while I was in the Army, I learnt respect for others, and concomitant with that was learning self-respect. And I came to be very good at what I was doing. And I was really very, very tempted to stay in a world that was often simpler and more easy to understand than Civvy Street. But I had also met a girl, got engaged, and I really didn't think the Army life was any place for a married man. So I walked away from it full-time and went into the reserve as a sort of a halfway measure, if you like, just to keep the skills and maintain some of the mateship. One of the things that provided me with that self-respect I mentioned was at 108 Field Battery, which was my subunit, part of 4th Field Regiment, and attached to 2 Battalion in Vietnam, was an incredibly fast and accurate gun battery. We fired 69,500 rounds in our year up there without a single error, or a single detectable error anyway, which is almost incomprehensible in artillery terms because there are so many variables. So we developed an enormous pride in how good we were. Our battery commander was a physical fitness fanatic, so we had sports days where we had a relay race, for instance, except that in the relay you towed a Land Rover with a gun on the back of it, 6 of you. The 100-metre sprint was exactly that, except that you had a man on your shoulders while you were doing it. We ran a 5-mile run every night, and the cooks and the clerks and everybody else, quartermaster staff, all did that run. And our little team used to do the 5 miles in 38 minutes, which in long pants and boots and in the tropics is a pretty fair achievement. So we developed an enormous pride and we developed an enormous brotherhood, such that we are still all close, or those of us who are still alive are still all close. We now have reunions every second year and almost everybody turns up to every reunion, no matter where in the country it is. Coming home was obviously a very meaningful experience, but it had some oddities to it. One was that we had to wait all day at Tan Son Nhut Airport because the Qantas charter that was taking us home and was bringing in replacements was late. So in that whole day we stayed in the airport. The only thing we could obtain was black coffee. There was no food, no sugar, no milk for the coffee. It was still serving as a civilian airport, so there were military aircraft everywhere and commercial aircraft in between them. But we got on the plane with all the alcohol that we'd stored and hidden, planning to have a great party on the way home to Sydney. And in fact, we all went to sleep straight away. And when we woke up, we were pretty much over Sydney. But I then went to the transport office at Kingsford Smith Airport and said, how do I get back to Melbourne? There were five of us going through to Melbourne. And he said, I've got no idea. I said, well, nor have I. And he said, stop whinging, you left from Brisbane. You're closer to home now than when you left. And this was, of course, before credit cards and we had no local currency. So NZANA decided that they could fit two of us on the next plane and TAA took the other three. And then one of us hitchhiked home to Witcherproof in the Mallee, which took him 2 days. It wasn't exactly a hero's homecoming, but the people treated us well. The system didn't, but the people did. When I came home and got married and became a civilian, I didn't really know what I wanted to be when I grew up. 50 years later, I was still wrestling with that issue, but I had done part of a teaching degree. I went back to Teachers College, finished that, and taught for the next 30 years. I became a principal in a very large school in what was then a fairly rough suburb and enjoyed that enormously. I had two children along the way who've been a delight to me in every way. I even had good dogs. In 1973, I started writing a newspaper column. That later provided two books, two collections of the stories, and a formal history of Gippsland, which grew out of the same study. I did a arts degree, then I did a Bachelor of Education, and subsequently I did a Master's degree in Educational Administration at New England. I did some diplomas and certificates along the way for different specific purposes. Had a really good and happy career. That was a very busy career, and I didn't join the RSL until 1999. It's been a good life, and I feel now that I have... I came home from Vietnam with all my arms and toes and fingers and legs and things, and I feel that gives me an obligation to those who came home a little bit damaged. And it's very satisfying to me that this RSL puts so much money into supporting young veterans, for instance. It's even more satisfying to me that we put so much care and thought into looking after those young veterans. So we might deal one morning with a 92-year-old widow, and later in the same morning we might be helping find accommodation for a 24-year-old Afghani war veteran. It's very satisfying. I was awarded an Order of Australia medal, partly for my work in education, partly for my work with the Dandenong community generally, and importantly, partly for my work in ex-service welfare. I'm very proud of that medal, but I'm actually more proud of a plaque that I was given at one of our reunions because I run our little newsletter and more or less run the organisation. It's very informal. And they presented me with a plaque thanking me for keeping them all together over the years. And at an emotional level, that probably means more to me than the OAM does. I had a stint as a headmaster at Gembrook Primary School in the early 80s. Then in 86, I think, I became the principal at Hallam Valley Primary School. In 88, I became the deputy principal at Hampton Park East Primary School, and then the principal of that school, which subsequently was renamed River Gum. And I remained there until I retired in the year 2000 and went off for another little bout of military service in East Timor. And I had the Millennium New Year in East Timor as a freelance journalist. And it was a strange thing because no newspaper knew I was there. Only my old subunit who were there knew that I was there completely unofficially. But the Navy took me over. The Thai Air Force brought me back. It was a real boy's own adventure. At some stage as secretary here, I realised that our history had never been put together in any meaningful way. And if the RSL is going to have a useful view of the future, it has to have an understanding of its past. and the things that have driven that past, and which of those things we want to take forward and which we don't. So I started putting together a history of the RSL, which we subsequently did, called Unwearied, obviously taken from the quote that age shall not weary them. It's a little push in the title to remind us that what we do has a very serious background. We have a duty to the 60,000 we lost in World War I, and to every man and woman we've lost since, and to everyone who has been hurt since. I have, I suppose, a passion for the RSL and for its potential. We help the community, we help the younger veterans, we help the older veterans, but there is an aspect of their role that we sometimes don't give sufficient importance. The RSL is in some ways the keeper of some of the best social values in our community. Not exclusively, but we are responsible for those values in many ways. So we must look forward, and we must take a long time frame, a 100-year timeline, not 5 years or 10 years, and say, what sort of country do we want our children growing up in, and what sort of views of themselves and their country do we want those children to have? We mustn't shy away from words like patriotism, responsibility, mateship, duty. They're fine words. They can be abused, but they're fine words. And we need to be taking them forward for hundreds of years to come.